China losing interest in pursuing infrastructure projects in the Philippines, the Mindanao Railway, among others. Do you think this is a form of political pressure, especially if we need or we want these projects very badly?
Well, Stanley, in my opinion, this is a temporary setback. The most important issue in this deal with China is the feasibility and the financing charges that China is charging us through AIIB.
Okay.
I understand through our research that the interest rates are much higher than the Japan ODA or much higher than the Korean or mm-hmm. other ODAs that are being extended to the Philippines. So the bottom line here, it's going to be much more costly to us compared to other ODAs. So in other words, the feasibility of these projects will also be affected. And we'll be paying for this. We have to remember ODAs are still considered loans, even though they're concessionary in nature, but they're still considered loans and the taxpayers will pay for it. So besides the geopolitical issues, bottom line is it's more expensive compared to other ODAs.
Okay. Now, aside from losing interest, China is also citing, well, the lingering political tensions with the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea as, of course, one of those reasons that are adding up to the burden or for these plans to even lose steam. Isn't it time now for the Philippines, you think, to reassess all China-funded projects, both the existing ones and those in the pipeline from the previous administration, to really rethink our position and see that we should or we would be more benefiting more from these projects than not? Because you mentioned earlier the interest rates are prohibitive and maybe disadvantages to the Philippines.
Well, I understand from also our research and also from news reports that none of the China-funded projects are actually pushing through, okay. or a lot of them are either delayed or a lot of them have financing issues, meaning interest rates issues. Mm-hmm. So again, we go back to the most important facet in this type of projects, the feasibility of it, and that is hinged on the interest rate and the financing cost that is being charged to us. Japan, World Bank, ADB, these multilaterals and these funding institutions have long history in funding the Philippines, and they have successfully funded many projects in our country with concessionary interest rates and concessionary terms. So we have very good relationship with them. So in other words, we can increase the amounts that we are drawing from these institutions. But then again, going back to the China loans and the China ODAs, we don't have much experience with them.
Okay.
And therefore, a lot of these projects are actually delayed. Okay. And again, the bottom line is it's much more expensive compared to the other ODAs.
Okay, so really, aside from the interests, what is advantages to the Philippines interest-wise? Relationship is also important. Is that what you're saying?
That relationship, experience, as well as track record, and the World Bank, ADB, JICA, even COICAP of Korea, these have long history in the Philippines in funding big ticket projects. For example, the most complex that JICA is funding right now is the subway system, which is most complex project that our country has ever undertaken, and quite long in terms of tenure. So this type of complex projects can be best undertaken with institutions that have long dealt with the Philippines. Of course, we want to deal with all types of ODAs or ODAs coming from different countries. But if it's going to be expensive for us and us, the taxpayers, will pay for it, then we cannot just go along just for the sake of going along. We have to also review the feasibility and also how much financing costs at the end of the day the taxpayers will pay. And I understand from news reports, from our research, that China still is quite expensive. So again, beside the geopolitical issues, besides what's happening in the West Philippine Sea, the feasibility of the China ODAs is not competitive.
Okay,
compared
as it is. As it is, no?
It is,
right,
as it
right.
is.
Okay, now these are important projects. We're talking about the Mindanao Railway project, the one linking south, another railway project, I suppose, and the one north of Luzon. Now, these are potential and very essential projects in terms of pushing economic activities in these areas. We understand that these projects must still be pursued with ODAs from other countries. Are there moves now to even pursue these possibilities and arrangements?
Railway is such an important infrastructure for any country, especially for an agriculture country like ours. Transporting goods, both raw materials and finished products, takes up so much of the retail cost to the consumers. Mm. So if you can lower down logistics costs by having an efficient railway system, that will be the best, especially in Luzon, where we all know that 60% of our economy comes from Luzon. Mm-hmm. And the South Railway should be pursued.
Okay.
Although over the years, we've already adopted by building South Express, the South Luzon Expressway. But then again, for heavy cargo, the railway is still the best.
Okay, now we've tackled ODA with China in terms of interest rates, which are prohibitive, in terms of relationship also, and the ongoing conflict, geopolitical conflict, as well as experience. Let's now talk about the way we handle all of these ODA projects, because there is a strat-based ADR Institute study recently. They presented it this year, warning that such projects must be thoroughly assessed as well from our side, that some form of better oversight must be done by the government if we are still to pursue these activities. Are we doing that as well? I mean, are you confident that the government has enough oversight over these deals?
That's a very good question, Stanley. In fact, we're in the middle of reviewing all of this ODA through the ODA oversight, joint ODA oversight committee, both in the House and in Congress. And just to put it simply, ODA projects are first studied by the NEDA to look at the feasibility, the funding, and of course benefit to us, the Filipino people. Then it's funded. The Department of Finance negotiates for the funding, negotiates for the terms of the funding, and then the implementing agency implements it. So the first is we have to study very carefully the feasibility of these projects. And over the years, the NEDA has approved a lot of projects. But the problem is when it comes to implementation. And we've detected so many ODA projects that are either encountered a lot of legal problems because there are bidding issues or implementation problems, for example, delays. And we also detected a lot of feasibility problems. Some of the projects are not feasible or not beneficial at all.
Okay.
And these are the things that we need to study carefully and tighten. We have to remember, regardless of the country that we contract ODAs, it's a loan. It's a it's concessional loan, meaning we will pay it 20 years from now, but it still forms part of the loan payments that we make every year. And that's why we need to study it before very carefully whether it's feasible or not, and make sure that it's implemented properly on time, or else there are financing costs if it's delayed.
Okay, a bigger picture now, Senator Gatchalian. We're in the crossroads. Times are changing. There are a lot of challenges in the economy globally, and you have a geopolitical landscape also changing. Now, this begs the question, is it now time for the Philippines to minimize its overdependence on maybe foreign loans for infrastructure? We need to be more resilient now with the sudden shifts in those fronts, economy and geopolitics. We are indebted to other countries right now more than we already are, and this is proving to be a disadvantage. How are you seeing this panning out?
Stanley, we are a very small... Our economy is very small.
Yeah.
We are a developing nation. And in order to grow fast, we need external sources to do so, whether it's investments, whether it's loan, whether it's capital raising or debt raising. Everything should be... The fastest way to grow our economy is to have external sources. And having said that, if we just confine ourselves to domestic borrowing, there are two things that can happen. We'll crowd out private investments. Mm-hmm. At the same time, the market is so small for government to tap into. Okay. So this is where FDI comes into play. Of course, the best case scenario is to get investments rather than borrow for infrastructure or mm-hmm. borrow for certain government projects. We invite them to invest. This is where PPP comes in.
Okay.
And PPP is actually inviting foreign sources to come in and invest in infrastructure. Mm-hmm. But if that is not feasible, then we don't have any choice but to right. go to the market and borrow. And this is where we have to be very prudent in terms of who to borrow from, mm-hmm. how much is the cost, and of course, all these geopolitical considerations in place.
Okay, a pretty complicated landscape.
It's a very complicated situation because all of this borrowings also has a certain level of geopolitical aspect. Like, for example, because Japan is a very close ally of ours and mm-hmm. we have long-standing relationship with them, they've been very generous in terms of extending a lot of ODA loans to us. Mm-hmm. The same with the European Union, albeit it's not so big. But if you look at our ODA portfolio, a lot of them come from allies of the Philippines.
Right. Okay. On another topic, cybersecurity, we have seen attacks on our government websites lately, which just reveals just how vulnerable our systems are from these attacks. Let's talk about enforcement first, Senator Gatchalian. Are you happy now with the way we're pursuing the bad actors behind these attacks?
Stanley, cyber attacks and all of these cyber threats is a clear and present danger.
Yeah.
It's reality. It's going to be a norm for the next many years. Yeah. And we need to prepare ourselves for that. The concerted attacks on the different government websites mm-hmm. is just an indication that we're vulnerable. And there are people, whether state-sponsored or non-state-sponsored, that are going to do attacks for the next many times.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to be ready for this. And it also showed that our institutions are not ready. Our capabilities are not ready.
Yeah.
Even our own human resource
right.
Is not ready. And this is where we need to develop through laws and policies. And I find that a bill, no? It's called the Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Bill, wherein critical infrastructure will have to follow global standards in terms of protecting their own selves.
Mm-hmm.
Even standards, we don't have that.
Okay. Now, let's talk about cyber defense. Do you agree we should do more or even spend more, if you will, to improve cybersecurity? And what steps now are being done? You already mentioned that this has to be a concerted effort, very deliberate from government. It is continuously evolving, something we can do in the next couple of years. So in terms of policy, what do you think will give us a better fighting chance against these attacks? When you talk about government policy and even laws?
Sadly, DICT, the PNP, NBI, they cannot do it. They cannot protect every single critical infrastructure in our country. When you say critical infrastructure, you're talking about all the distribution utilities, 121 mm-hmm. of them.
Mm-hmm.
You have the transmission lines. You have the water distribution companies. You have
right.
banks who are considered critical infrastructure. Airports. So all of these critical infrastructures cannot be protected by DICT mm-hmm. or PNP alone. The private sector needs to step up
okay.
and needs to organize themselves and come up with policies and standards to protect their own critical infrastructure. And this is where the law will come in.
Okay.
And because the law will now mandate critical infrastructure operators to follow standards, and not only that, but to come up with a plan and also a dedicated team or person to implement that plan.
All right. Speaking of private sector and the cyber world in the Philippines, South China Morning Post wrote about hackers having easily broken into government website one time using just plain password admin123. Very simple password for a government website. Now, the same article's also saying this reflects the authorities, Philippine authorities referred to, lax attitude towards cybersecurity and even exposing some of the country's top military secrets on the dark web. How alarming is that?
Well, sadly, I haven't read that article and I haven't really analyzed that article. But if the article's accurate, that goes to show the level of appreciation in terms of cybersecurity in our country, that even government employees, government actors don't appreciate that. They think cybersecurity is just on television or the movies. When they see cybersecurity and cyber attacks, they just think that it's just happening in the movies. But it's not. It's happening now. It's real and present danger. And, you know, sometimes in our country, we have this bad habit, unless it's we're all affected badly.
We do not do anything, right?
Do not do anything. And that's a bad habit that we need to shed off. And that's why all of these attacks that we've seen, maybe it's not as bad as crippling the economy, but we have to take that seriously and improve ourselves. And again, we need to enact laws that will involve the private sector. The government cannot do it alone. DICT cannot do it alone. With the budget that they have, it's impossible for them to protect everyone. But the private sector can come up with policies and standards to protect critical infrastructures.
Okay, so you already brought up budget. Now, lastly, we're talking about resources that must come in. Now, the same article is saying the typical government agency is sloppy. This is a description from that article. The government is sloppy and it lacks experts, lacking funding. Do you feel that more funding, more budget will be needed or should be pushed for government agencies to patrol our cyberspace?
I'll be realistic, Stanley. More budget or a ideal budget will be quite impossible in the short term because it's a tug of war when they do budgeting.
Yeah.
That's why we need to involve the private sector. I keep on repeating this because I see articles blaming the DICT or the PNP, but if you look at their budget for cybersecurity and for protection of critical infrastructure, it's not so much. And we're talking about huge companies that span across the country. So that's why we need to change our track and make sure that these companies, private or public, should have certain standards, certain global standards that they should follow in terms of cyber protection, and also come up with their own investment in terms of protecting critical infrastructure and their own companies.
All right, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, we thank you so much for joining the Head Start this morning. Have a great day.
Thank you very much, Stanley.